Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. First, I want to thank Madeleine Albright for her remarks, her service as Ambassador to the United Nations and Secretary of State when I was in office, and the magnificent work she has continued to do. She is a symbol, to me anyway, of how we can grow up in an interdependent world full of troubles, even killing, and turn it to positive good. I thank the dinner co-chairs, the IRC board, and overseers. I want to join Madeleine in congratulating George Soros. It's hard to think of any citizen of the world who would have done more to deserve the award you are giving him tonight. I really like the IRC. I just do. I like the fact that you go to hard places, that you're dealing with the crushing refugee problems in Syria and Jordan and 38 other countries now, that you do it with a commitment to be fast and lean and good with only 7% overhead, which I appreciate having tried to run a big foundation. I appreciate the fact that you try to help refugees reintegrate their lives in other countries, including the United States. I am grateful that the IRC has been an astonishingly active partner with the Clinton Global Initiative in promoting projects around the world, 10 times as a participating partner, 7 times as a principal, where you have made commitments now being kept worth more than $250 million, including one of my favorites, training teachers in the Democratic Republic of Congo to provide education to almost 500,000 Congolese children who desperately need it. Today, the IRC is supporting more than 350 schools with more than 4,000 teachers that you have trained. And I am very grateful. But there are lots of other projects. There are literally 20 projects I could talk about that the IRC has been involved in just through the Clinton Global Initiative. So for all of you who are here in support of them, I thank you for that. A few years ago, the IRC honored President Bush, the first President Bush and me, with an award for the work we had done in the Indonesian tsunami and later in the area affected by Katrina. After I worked with him for a while, I agreed to be the UN coordinator for the tsunami relief, and I worked for several more years, both in Indonesia and other affected countries. This is what I know. It was a long time ago now in the way we measure years, but actually less than a decade ago. After the tsunami in late 2004, within just 1 year, the IRC had already given 153,000 people safe drinking water, 58,000 people health treatments through their mobile units, helped more than 10,000 children return to school, and arranged for the reemployment with a secure income of 23,000 people in less than 12 months. That's the kind of thing that we're used to seeing the IRC do, and something that every citizen of this country and every other country that supports it should be grateful for. My real job here is to introduce David Miliband, but I want to talk about him in the context of the mission of the IRC. I was thrilled, and I must say, just a tad jealous when the IRC asked David to become president and CEO. I couldn't tell whether I was jealous that he wasn't running my foundation or that I wasn't asked to run yours. But somewhere in there, there was constructive jealousy. I have known David Miliband for almost 20 years. And as all of you who are really active in the IRC have doubtless already discovered, he and Louise are both remarkable people. We worked very closely together when Tony Blair was Prime Minister and I was President, and we were trying to make sense of a 21st century world beginning just a few years before the turn of the century that was interdependent as never before, but unleashing both positive and negative consequences of that interdependence. I believe he is one of the most gifted public servants I have ever known. He's uncannily wise for his age, which I resent. You know, I don't know how this happened. I spent most of my life being the youngest person doing whatever I was doing. And then one day I woke up and I was the oldest man in every room. I don't know how it happened. But I always tell my fellow Americans, if they have reservations about immigration reform, they better get over it, because I can now say with absolute conviction, youth matters. Once you don't have it, you know that. And democracy is very important. What's all that got to do with this? David Miliband embodies to me the promise of the work the IRC does. Since I left the White House, one of the four or five most profound moments I've had occurred in a camp in Aceh in Indonesia. I was then the UN ambassador for our envoy to help fix it. And housing is always the toughest thing. And we had 40,000 people in one of these camps that was incredibly hot and musty and uncomfortable. 6 months passed when I told them they were all going to be in homes. So I had to go there and take the appropriate tongue lashing and tell them what I had tried to do to get back on schedule. And as I was being briefed, I drove up to the camp. They said, well, you'll be met by the president of the camp and a young interpreter who used to be a television commentator in Indonesia and gave up her television career to work in the camps to help the people get their lives back. So I get out of the car, and here's the president of the camp, who just a man who was a simple citizen, and his wife and his son, who was 10 years old, and I believe is the single most beautiful child I had ever seen. Luminous eyes, fabulous smile, just in an eerie, almost spiritual calm aura emanating from him. So I met them, then the president's, camp president's wife and son excused himself, and I was walking down to get my tongue lashing with the president and the interpreter. And I looked at the young interpreter and I said, I believe that boy is the most beautiful child I ever saw. And she smiled and said, yes, he's very beautiful. And before the tsunami, he had 9 brothers and sisters. They're all gone now, all of them. So I proceeded to spend an hour and a half with this camp president, going through every last section of the camp. Not one time did a smile ever leave his face. Not one time did he ever say anything about his personal loss. Every single solitary thing he said was about what the people he represented needed to do the job that you do at the IRC. And when we got to the end of this tour, they finished in the health clinic because they knew my foundation did a lot of work in healthcare and they wanted to show me what they were doing. And all of a sudden, the president's wife, who had lost her 9 children, showed up holding a baby. And she said, before you go, we wanted to thank you for your efforts by giving you the honor of naming the youngest child in our camp. This child was born 2 days ago. And she, I always hesitate to say this in America for fear I'm going to spark a social revolution, because she said, I am carrying the child because in our culture, when a woman has a baby, she gets to go to bed for 40 days and be properly taken care of as she nourishes her baby. She said, then after 40 days, she gets up and we have a formal naming of the child. But we want to jump the gun. We want you to be able to name the child. And the interpreter's giving me all this, and the mother's there brightly child, smiling, holding this baby as if he were her own. And I looked at the mother and the father, and I said, is there a word in your language for new beginnings? And so the translator gave it to them, and the mother smiled. And then the translator smiled, and she looked at me, and she said, lucky for you, in our language, the word dawn is a boy's name, not a girl's name. She said, the mother said, we will name this boy Dawn, and he will symbolize our new beginning. And whenever I feel discouraged, I think about that woman holding that baby, knowing she had lost 9 of her 10 children. Still with a smile on her face, I think about the father who lost those children, never saying anything about his own loss, but only putting himself in a position of helping those in continuing need. And all my resentments seem small. And the opportunity of every new day seems big. That is what the IRC means, not just to me, but now to countless millions of people around the world. The burden of getting people to think like that while this violence is going on in Syria, for the people in the camps in Syria and in Jordan, is enormous. The burden of getting people in different cultures more prone to vengeance than reconciliation to think like that is enormous. But think about that boy. The 9 who were gone, the son who survived, the parents who lifted up an infant. They are what the IRC is all about. And you could not be better led than by David Miliband.
Fantastic speech. Fantastic speech. You've given a great speech. Thank you very much. Fantastic speech. Really beautiful.